Well, hi, everybody, and welcome to this very special webcast called A Walk in Rome with Scott Kelby. My name is Matt Kluskowski, and we're here on the set of Kelby Training based on a couple of webcasts that we've done in the past. One was in Cuba, after you'd taken a Cuba trip, and another one was in Paris. And everybody always liked kind of getting a little bit of the behind the scenes of a travel photography trip, where you're actually out there taking the pictures. You got ideas on how other people can get out there and take those pictures, and then what to do with those photos when they get back. So, with no further ado, let's talk to the guy who actually walked in Rome.
That was a do? Well, hi, everybody. Thank you for joining me tonight. One of the things that I'm going to do we'll talk about, of course, the photography. We're going to talk about the gear. We're going to talk about post-processing. We're going to talk about Photoshop and Lightroom and all the different things that we can do. I also want to talk to you really briefly to let you know how I do travel photography, mm-hmm. because it's different than a traditional travel photographer. I do travel photography the same way you do travel photography. I really do it based on, I'm on vacation. So I know that there are travel photographers and they'll go to a region for 2 weeks and they're there to shoot.
Just to take photos.
Right, just to take photos. I'm not that guy. I'm there with my wife, in this case, my brother and my brethren and my sister-in-law and all these folks. And we're taking tours, we're getting on tour buses, we're going shopping, we're doing the same stuff that everybody else does. And that's the kind of travel photography I teach, which I think is the everyman travel photography, right?
And I think it kind of gives you a good outlook on a lot of the same things that people run into, which is, you know, the tours aren't always at sunrise and sunset.
No.
And you're usually not the only person on the tour. There's you and 6,000 other tourists
and the tour bus has X amount of minutes at this stop to take pictures.
Yeah.
And that's the way that I wind up doing it. And I'm cool with that because I'm doing this for fun, just like you are, right?
Yeah.
I'm taking pictures because I love to take pictures on vacation. I love to bring back memories. Now, I do two sorts of pictures. I do pictures of my family and my brother and all that kind of stuff. And those go into one photo album. And then I do pictures for me. The pictures that I like to take as a photographer, and those go in another photo album. But they're all taken at the exact same time. It's just, you know, I will only be showing tonight the pictures that I take for me as a photographer. So that's basically my scoop as far as how these shots are taken.
Okay.
Literally taken on vacation.
All right, so we're going to get right to it. We have some prizes that we're going to give away. So I'll mention those quick, and then I'll turn it back over to you. So the very first prize is we have two $100 gift cards for B&H Photo.
Woo.
Can I have one? We've got $20 off a Kelby Training subscription, and we've got a kit, the Rogue Portrait Lighting Kit.
That whole kit right there.
Happens to be sitting right here. And then we also have a Canon Vixia Mini.
Yeah, so that's like a video camera with built-in Wi-Fi.
Yeah, and it's pretty cool. I saw it on Photoshop World. It's got a little flip screen.
Fisheye, and then, yeah, it's nice.
It's very cool. So we've got those prizes that we'll be able to give away later on. And actually, I think the best thing to do is just jump right into it.
All right, so what I'm going to take you through is a photo book. Now, I use Lightroom to make all my photo books. I don't know which camera to look at. How about if I look at that one? Hi.
Hey. Hi. Real quick, though. I want to start off the trip. Did you? This was you and your wife.
It was myself and my wife, my brother and his girl, and we had some friends that met us over there. You know, we met all kinds of crazy friends. We had when I went on the aircraft carrier last year, the Navy Photographer of the Year, Anthony Curtis, wound up being stationed in Sicily. He and his wife came up, and then my friend Serge came from Paris with his wife Karen. We had a bunch of buddies there. It was wonderful.
Okay. But so kind of, it's like the trip that kind of grew.
It did, it grew. And then it grew into the last day of my trip, or the second day of my trip, being my worldwide photo walk. So I did my photo walk as part of my, you know, there's 1,200 cities around the world. My city was Rome.
Okay.
It's kind of a cheesy business excuse to go to Rome. But, you know, it was business. I had to go. Okay. So I did a photo book. I used Lightroom to make my photo books. And you can take a look on screen here. This is the start of it. And so what we're going to do is, every time I do a trip, one of the most exciting things for me is to make a photo book. I think it adds that third creative part of the process. I love shooting. I love post-processing. But then now I have this new part where I get to put, and there's an art to kind of putting the pictures mm-hmm. together, which ones work with which ones. And I think that's a lot of fun. So I'm going to kind of take you through the book. And then when we when we get to parts that, you know, we can either discuss the image or do a tutorial or something, we'll just do it as it comes.
And we have comments too, so if anybody's got questions along the way or anything like that, we'll be able to get those.
Yes,
as well.
Brad Moore is here helping us out with the comments. So, all right, so I'm going to hide the panels here, but I build these books in Lightroom. The first step is to put all of your favorite images in a collection. So you start that. And then from there on, you build the books. But it starts with getting your final images all together, put them in a collection, then we build the book. Hey, first question we got here was from, I think it's Traveling Babe, but there I can't see if you look on the screen. It's
what company do you use to print them?
Yeah, there we go. Traveling Babe. If you print out of Lightroom, it automatically goes to Blurb. Mm-hmm. So Blurb.com does it. At the very end, you'll see a little button that says Print to Blurb, and away you go, and it just uploads it. Okay, so let me just hide the panels here. I'm hitting Shift Tab, which hides all the panels. I kind of picked a random image to be the cover page because, well, it's kind of random. And we'll talk about this scene and all this stuff a little bit later in, but we'll go ahead and go through. So this is the first page of the book. It's interesting, this is actually, it's a very famous, this has been shot to death, okay? So I'm not covering any new ground here. I will tell you what's different about my photo than most of the other photographers' photos that I've seen. There's nobody there. So this is actually usually, I mean, you do see occasionally, you know, when someone, you've cloned out people or something, but it was literally empty like this. And this is in the Vatican, which is a pretty popular place, by the way, in Rome.
And a few people visit.
Believe it or not, this is in the gift shop. So I even have a little picture of it. I think I brought a little picture that I can show you of the gift shop here. I think I put it in... I'll have to find it in a minute. I do have a picture of it in the, you'll see it in a few minutes.
So it's like one of those things, like when you walk out of the gift shop, that's
when
there?
When you leave, yeah, you walk out of, so what happened was, if you go and you wait in line at the Vatican to get in, I'm not joking, it's 3 hours long. 3 hours long. And what's amazing about it is, if you get a private tour, you can walk right in. They have a separate entrance for private tours. You already did. Best money I've ever spent. And I'll get you the link to the tour company, because the tour company I used, outstanding, incredible. But anyway, they walk you right in, and the first place we went was just outside this gift shop. Now, I am on my phone on Google to ask our tour guide, where's this? Where's the staircase? So I'm looking on Google, and there's a million shots of this staircase. Where is this? And as I'm waiting, because she's talking to my wife and she's explaining everything in this hallway. So as I'm on my phone, I look over and I see the gift shop. I didn't realize it was in the gift shop. I thought this was in some amazing place. And I look over and I see the spiral, like one of the little things go down. And I just walk away. And the tour guide's giving that look like, you're walking away. And I walk
here.
Away and I look and it's completely empty. And literally all I did was hang over the side. Click, 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 click. You know, I shot it.
Do you have a tripod or?
No, handheld. I don't know. They don't like you setting up a tripod in the Vatican. they'll break your legs. So I'm just literally hanging over the side and aiming down. And I just kind of walked around it and took shots all the way around. And this was my favorite one. But it, I mean, there's nothing to it. The most amazing thing about it is there's nobody there. It was 7 o'clock in the morning. No one's even got into the Vatican. The Vatican opens. The private tour gets you in an hour before the public. You have the Vatican to yourself for an hour before the public gets there. So, and believe me, it's amazing to be in there an hour before, because when they open the doors, have you ever been to Disney World and you've waited in line for like a show, and then the doors open and everyone pours to get their seats? Imagine that for hours, because once the public's in, it is just a solid stream of people. You can't stop and look at anything.
Yeah.
It's just, you're just moving as part of a giant mass. In here, I'm all by myself.
I mean, ballpark, a private tour costs
$50 or so. It wasn't very much. And if you think I can get my favorite pictures of the Vatican for an extra $50, it was very inexpensive. It's a walking tour.
Yeah.
It was very inexpensive.
And I think that's a good tip for people too. I know personally, like when I go somewhere, I don't necessarily think like I want to take these private tours. I may like the photography. I may like the shot that I want to take somewhere, but like I don't really need a private tour. But the private tour is what helps you get some of those off hours where you can get into these places.
They get you access to places you wouldn't normally get at times that you wouldn't normally get. So, I mean, that I thought was wonderful. So that's the story on the staircase is, it's an easy shot to get. It's a no-brainer. Lean over the you know, with a wide angle lens and go click and you're set. So the thing that made it cool was strictly that. So that's the opening page of the book because it's just been shot to death. And I thought, well, why not? Let's go ahead and show that. So the highlight of the Vatican tour actually wasn't the Vatican. Sistine Chapel, you know, where Michelangelo painted. Mm-hmm. It's very small. It's very dark. And the first time I went through, it was morning, and there was 45, 50 people. And the second time I went through, there was 1,100 in a room made for 200. But the Sistine Chapel at the end was absolutely unbelievable. You can't set up a tripod because it's kind of full of people, too. So literally, all I could do was stand there, lean up, and, you know, luckily the camera's kind of leaning against your face. And one of the tricks, I think, to getting sharp shots in low light, of course, is raise your ISO. Mm-hmm. And the camera I was using worked out really well. I didn't have to, you know, I was shooting at maybe 800 to 1600 ISO. But one of the tricks is to shoot in high-speed continuous mode. Because what's going to happen is you're in a low light and you go click, 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 and you get 8 or 9 different
versions of the photo.
And the first one's really blurry, and the second one's really blurry, and the third one's really blurry, and then bang, all of a sudden,
there's one
that's just tack on sharp. For whatever reason, at some moment, it literally all came together. So I think the important thing is, if you're in a low light situation and you don't have enough ISO, I mean, you may not have a camera that'll let you go up to 1600 and be really clean. And so I just shoot a number of shots. Luckily, this camera was very clean. There's no noise. I haven't done any noise reduction on anything at all. I know we're getting, this is so funny. Very first question. What is the name of the font Scott used on the cover of the book? I went and wrote it down because it's one of my favorite fonts. And I had it uninstalled and I just reinstalled it a couple of weeks ago. I'm like, there it is. It's called Satisfaction. It's from myfonts.com. So myfonts.com, it's $20. Oh, look at this. You guys are on it. So if you go in the search there and type in right over there and type in Satisfaction, you'll see the font, $20. Greatest. And it works well for so many things. There it is, Satisfaction. And there's the font. I love that font. It is just, I've used it for so many things over the years. $20. How do you beat that? So that's the name of the font. And I had that on my list to tell, and somebody asked the question. Kenbar Photo asks a Lightroom question. If you edit a photo after it's been included in the book, will the image automatically update in the book as well? Absolutely. So all you do is, I want to see. I got a computer right here. So let's say I wanted to edit this photo. I just, while that photo is live, right, I go over to the develop module, and look, it takes that picture over there. If I wanted to make it black and white, I just would click the, I would do more than that. We'll do a black and white conversion here in a little while. And then when you go back to the book, within 45 minutes to an hour, no, there you go. It's black and white. So yeah, all this stuff is live. And this is so handy when you're working on a book because, you know, you're moving and you go, this doesn't look quite right on this page. Maybe it needs to be brighter.
Yeah.
If you want to put it on a dark background, you just jump over to develop, make it a little brighter and come back. Because Lightroom gives you the option of having a white background, a black background, a color background on a page, but you normally use white or black. Well, sometimes when you think a black background looks good for this two-page spread, the photo sometimes looks too dark, mm-hmm. right? Because it looks very different when you look at a photo
black
on a black with surrounded by black versus surrounded by white. So you jump over to develop, make a little change, come back. I love that. I love that about the way Lightroom builds books. Let's see. Where did you find your tour company? The tour company. It was actually a friend recommended them, and I'll get their name for you in just a moment. But friend recommended them, couldn't say enough about them. They were even better than he said they were.
Really?
But yeah, I just want to make sure I get their name right. I'm not gonna say the name because I'll get it wrong. I'll have it for you in just a moment. I'll get it for you. Let's see. Carlos Fandango says, I married the love of my life 3 weeks ago, and I went on a whistle-stop road through the Maritimes. I have over 1,500 photos and an hour of video. I'm glad I learned from Scott and Matt how to set up a good workflow and get organized in Lightroom. I have a dozen galleries to make, one from each city along the route. We had a blast, and I'll be making photographs for the wedding guests and our own coffee table. Thanks for the guidance. You're very welcome, Carlos.
Awesome.
And you'll have so much fun, making photo books.
It's a great way to share your trip.
Our buddy Serge is up late in France tonight. Bonjour, Monsieur Beaujolais. That's what he wrote. Hey, Mr. Serge. Okay, so anyway, getting the shots in the Sistine Chapel, I talk about this on my tour. I don't want to take any credit for it because honestly, you're in the most amazing, one of the most amazing buildings in the world, and you just look straight up it, and there it is. That's the problem with the Sistine Chapel, is everywhere you go, it looks wonderful up it. So I have some of the Vatican pictures up front. This one is, this is outside of the Pantheon, not the Parthenon, that's in Greece, the Pantheon, which is outside of this little facade here, is quite an ugly building on the outside, but once you step inside, it's absolutely amazing. On Twitter, right before we went on the air, somebody asked, are you going to cover how to do a black and white conversion?
Yes,
and yeah, sure, why not? So let me go ahead and jump over here, and we'll do one real quick. Let me jump over to, let's get out of the here and go to the... jump over to a black and here we go. Here's that same photo. So I just want you to keep this in mind because I have a strategy I keep in mind when I'm doing black and white. Black and white photos, what makes a great black and white photo is literally contrast. My job, I think, as a photographer, as an editor, is to make a very, very high contrast. We really respond to high contrast. So for example, if I just choose the black and white button, if I just click on black and white, it just kind of gives you, in my opinion, a very flat
gray.
Looking. Just it looks gray, yeah. Right? So what I want to do is I'm going to make a duplicate of this. I'm going to go Command and an apostrophe to make a virtual copy. So that way I can show you a before and after back to the black and white. All right, so now the black, now this thing is the original image. So the first thing I might do is, remember, I'm trying to make things, the whites as bright as I can, the blacks as deep as I can, mm-hmm. and that kind of stuff. So I'm gonna move the exposure. I have a little clipping, but it's over there. I don't really care about that. So it's just, you know, the sky over there. I can bring that back with pulling back my highlights and stuff. But I'm gonna try to push my exposure as far as I can. I'm gonna bump up the contrast as far as I can. Now you can see it's getting really dark and stuff inside of there. So let's bring up the shadows. But what the thing that makes black and white rock, clarity.
Oh yeah, because at that edge.
So look at what clarity does. Look at the difference.
Oh, yeah.
All right. And then now I'm going to go to the blacks and whites and just see if I can get away with adding some more blacks in. Actually, the whites are kind of bright. I might lower the exposure just a little bit. But what I'm really trying to do is how far can I push this? How much can I get away without just clipping like mad? I am clipping a little bit. Look at that little area over there. I don't care really about that. So I'm just going to... if it goes to solid white, I'm really okay with it. And I think I might even just increase the blacks a little bit more. I'm looking for just a real high cut. Look at the difference. Just moving those few sliders make. And then you're gonna sharpen it to death, right? Because that's another thing, a characteristic of good black and white, is sharpen the daylights out of it. Go over here to the detail panel, go to amount and just go woo, you know, and just make it really crispy and sharp. You might even raise the radius to maybe like 1.5 or something. I mean, really, ooh, yeah, hootich.
You don't add a vignette, do you?
Well, you know, Matt, but look at the difference here. Look how flat that was.
So that's a before, right? That's just the regular.
Right, so there's before, regular black and white conversion, and there's mega black and white.
Oh, it's huge.
So the only thing I could say is maybe it's a little bright on the whites. You know, maybe I went a little too far. But again, this is all... to taste, so I could maybe take the whites down just a hair, but man, I really push the sliders on a black and white.
Hey, we got a good question too. So Evan asks, what's the difference between converting to black and white in that panel, the panel you were just in,
right,
or going to the color HSL black and white panel?
Okay, who asked the question? It was Evan. So
Evan,
I never, ever, ever go to the black and white panel. Honestly, because it has these sliders, right, that allow you to change the color of the photo. But here's what kills me. It gives you the black and white mix. It lets you adjust the reds, the orange, the yellows, the green, the aqua, except for you can't see any of those colors. It's a black and white photo. And if you hit the auto button, it looks bad. If you hit the default button, it looks bad. It all basically looks bad. And so I always do all of mine right up here. You know what it is? I just treat it like it's a color photo that I want a lot of contrast to.
Yeah, and I think one thing that'll help Evan out too is when you click that little black and white option, if you kind of hover your cursor around, when you click that black and white option, Evan, it turns the black and white panel on down there.
Right, right.
It's just you're just not going to that black and white panel to tweak it. You're doing it with contrast.
Right, and I much prefer to do it because you know what it is? You're just kind of fishing around in the dark there. Mm-hmm. Now, there is one little feature, one tiny one, Evan, that I do like in the in that panel is if you were to go here, if there was a particular area where you go, I just want to adjust that area, what you can do is there's this thing called the targeted adjustment tool. I'm going to zoom in so you can see it right there. This little targeted adjustment tool called the TAT for short. You can take this and say, I want to adjust this area. Click and drag up and it adjusts those tones. Click and drag down and it lowers those tones. So you could use this as a visual way. If you just didn't know where to adjust a particular area of your photo, you can grab this tool and zoom over there. So what's the downside of this? This looks pretty cool, right? Well, the downside is it doesn't just adjust the area where you're at. It adjusts all the tones like that in your entire photo, which is why if I do go here, it's when I know I need to move one little thing, like I need to be that, and this needs to be a little brighter, and I don't care what happens to the rest of the photo.
Yeah.
Other than that, though, I just kind of stay away from there.
All right.
Oh, Costa asks, do you use a program to get rid of noise, or do you just adjust it in Lightroom? I don't get rid of noise. I know that sounds crazy, but so unless you're going to print, right? If I'm going to go print this, so this is going to be a print book, I might be worried about noise. Now, I shot a camera. We'll talk about gear in a minute. I shot a camera that's great in low noise, so I was shooting at 1600 ISO, 2000 ISO. You don't see any noise in these photos. There is no noise reduction in any of them. But if you actually blew it up to 100%, mm-hmm. right? So how big is the biggest photo in this entire thing going to be? This big, right?
Yeah.
Full page. Maybe a two-page spread. How big are the files that the camera takes? This big. If we go into Photoshop and we blow it up to 100%, we're going to see noise. And you know what's weird? That's where we judge our noise. We judge our noise at a size that no one will ever see that image ever. If it's on the web, how big is this big is going to be? This big. But we judge our noise on a completely unrealistic thing, which is why I don't do any noise reduction at all. The biggest my image is going to get is this big, and you're not going to see any noise.
But if you do noise reduction, it's usually in Lightroom, right?
Absolutely.
You don't have a third-party program or anything like that.
Right. Here's why if you need noise reduction, why Lightroom is so good, is because it applies the noise reduction to the raw photo. It doesn't convert it to a JPEG and then apply it. You're applying it at that raw level, and that makes a huge difference. If I ever need to use noise reduction, I use what's built into here. And by the way, if you shoot in RAW, it automatically applies, by default, a tiny, tiny little bit of noise reduction. It's just, you don't even have to look, you don't even go there, you're like, really, it does that? It really does. Because when you shoot in RAW, you're turning off any noise reduction in your camera. So Adobe kind of gives you a little back so you don't sell your camera.
All right. Hey,
there you go.
You want to take a quick break?
Absolutely.
We're going to take a very, very quick break. Before we do that, two things. One, there's lots of gear questions. We'll grill you on your gear when we get back from the break. Number two, we're going to give some stuff away first. So we've got B&H gift cards to give away. So lucky person will win a $100 B&H gift card. And by the way, you can enter in these with the comments that are on the website there where you're watching the podcast, the chat. So that's how you enter into the contest. So we will have a lucky person that will win a B&H gift card. I'm waiting for that lucky person. Keep singing.
Lucky person.
We're waiting for that lucky person's name to magically appear because we wanted to give everybody.
After the break.
Oh, after the break.
After the break.
The word after, that means after.
Brad just says the word after means after.
It says do the B&H gift cards before we go to break.
And after the break, we'll pick the winners. Okay.
All right. Hey. So we're going to leave a comment, do something. We'll enter you into the contest. We'll see you back here in just a minute.
Yeah, lots more fun stuff.
Welcome everybody, RC here. Welcome to Exposing HDR here on Kelby Training. Now, the best place for you to do all of this stuff is gonna be in this room.
He's back.
Go away.
Let's go.
The gear isn't your trophy. It's the photographs you take. Hey, I'm Zach Arias. Follow me for 2 days as I shoot street portraits. And then I sit down with a Pulitzer Prize winning photo editor to talk about photography. So check out my class, The $5,000 Challenge, at kelbytraining.com.
Hey, we are back. Live webcast here with Scott Kelby called A Walk in Rome, and we're doing just that. You're kind of walking us through some of the photos that you took in Rome and some of the stories and camera settings and post-processing behind all of them.
Hey, I looked up the website.
Cool.
Walksofitaly.com. I wanted to make sure it wasn't italywalks.com. It's walksofitaly.com. That's their website right there. These people rock. I got to tell you, the guide we had, she was so wonderful. And you know what I liked about her? Once she realized, you know, I said, you know, I'm a photographer and I'm really interested, because I wandered off, you know, kind of come back and say, look, you know, I mean, I love all this stuff. It's cool, but I want to be taking photos as I go. And so I showed her the picture of the, and she was like, ooh. And then she was incredibly accommodating. Like, she goes, like, I know you want pictures. Why don't you look in this room? And, you know, once she realized that was something that meant something to me, she really was like on the lookout. And she was so wonderful. She spoke perfect English, you know, so she was wonderful. But we had a three different tours set up with them. And honestly, just, I can't say enough about them. Now, they were recommended to me. And so,
awesome.
Anyway, but let me put it this way. When I go back to Rome, and I'm going to go, and you should go. Can I tell you something about Rome? If you're watching this and you're thinking, well, I haven't got enough to really show you any pictures to make you want to go, but I'm hoping at the end of this you'll go, wow, I got to go. You know that I had Brad look online a few minutes ago. You can fly round trip from New York to Rome, $718 on Aer Lingus, which is interesting because Aer Lingus is a Irish airline. But they go from Tampa, it's a little more from Tampa, but you can go JFK to...
Really?
$718. You can't buy a lens for $718.
My flight to Portland cost pretty close to that.
I know, $718 round trip to Rome. So anyway, there's lots of
cool.
You got to go.
All right,
we have some winners.
We do have some contest winners. First contest winner is appropriately named Loves Scott.
Yeah. By the way, if you're named Loves Scott, you're guaranteed to win almost.
Did Kaliber leave that one?
No, it's not my one.
Did she want a $100 V&F gift card?
Random. And who else?
It must have been Brad. And then Sytog, S-Y-T-T-O-G.
So we're going to let them know somehow that they won.
Yep.
Brad will let them know.
All right. Back to the book.
All right. Hey, so I want to answer a question real quick for K-Man. K-Man says, what about property and model releases when you travel? So here's the thing. You don't need property and model releases when you travel unless you're going to sell these photos as stock photography, or you're going to use the people in some kind of an advertisement. So, for example, let's say that I show these photos and I make photo books and I do whatever. And even if I make prints, even if I make individual prints and I sell them. But if I get a call from like Exxon, which is unlikely, but if Exxon calls and says, wow, we love this shot of Rome, can we use this shot of this woman walking down the street for one of our ads? The answer is no. And by the way, you're probably not going to get a model release from a strange woman
walking
on Rome. Because number one, it probably doesn't even matter. Model release probably wouldn't even work in Italian law. But imagine how you would feel if a stranger walks up and says, hey, you weren't looking, but I took your picture. Can you please sign this contract? Bang! So, yeah, going up to strangers on the street and trying to get property releases. So, what I recommend for K-Man, since I am not an attorney and I'm not qualified to give legal advice, go to Kelby Training. Even if you're not a subscriber, you can rent the class on copyrights and model release, and it is absolutely wonderful. You can rent the class. Ed Greenberg, a New York attorney,
Jack
Resnicki. They're unbelievable, and they will open your eyes to things that you never dreamed about. So if that's a concern of yours, watch their class, and you're going to go, oh, and you'll know what you can and can't do with those pictures. But basically, like, you know what surprised me that I learned about? Where you can take a picture of somebody, make 1,000 prints, sell them out of your own printer to whoever you want. They don't get any, you know. There's a certain point where you get to mass production where you would have to get a model release.
Yeah, that's interesting.
But remember, we had him on Photoshop User a while back, and I'm sitting there going, no, really? But, you know, that's how street photographers, you know, look at Jay Mazel.
Yeah.
Jay and I run around asking people for, can you imagine
that's
Jay
true.
Mazel? Hey, I need you to sign this, kid. All right, anyway. So let's look at a couple more images here real quick as we're going through the book. And you're going to see, you know. So this was taken also in the Sistine Chapel. I saw this guard sitting here reading a book. And what I liked about it was, it's just the light. You know, he's looking down and the light was so pretty. But you know what the problem is? There's this weird thing that when you go to take a picture of someone who's not looking, they can sense it. They can, I snap this one and then he looks up at me and I'm kind of, I walk out of the room and even the guide, I show the guide the picture and she's like, you have to go back and get another picture of him. I walk in the room and now he's locked eyes on me. And I couldn't get another picture of him. I just couldn't. He was like looking at me like, don't even think about it. And I kept walking into different rooms. And I spent about 10 minutes trying to get him. You know, and then he wouldn't look down anymore. It was just like, hey, the picture on the right is, it looks better than it really looked because... No, it looks like it looked to my eye. It doesn't look like it looked to my camera.
Oh, yeah.
And the problem with this picture is, well, I'm gonna jump over to the develop module and show you exactly the problem. Here's what it looked like when I took it. Reset. Oh, crud, it's a JPEG. It's baked in. Let me see if I have this image. I might have it here. Hold on, that's not this image, obviously.
So you know what they need to make as you're finding that image?
Yeah, look at Matt for a second. I'm going to grab it out of here.
What they need to make is, because you ever look, you look through the viewfinder in the camera, everything looks good.
Right.
They need to make a button that says, take what I see in there. Just let me look through there. Whatever I see, let me click and take, let me click and let me just take that picture. And that's the way you should make one picture look. If they did that.
Right. Well, but you know what it is? They haven't made cameras yet that will let you see
That will take what your eye sees,
because your eye is amazing. It adjusts for all kinds of things where the rest of you won't. And so, Matt, talk for just 1 second while I grab this photo. I'm so close to it.
I would say that is largely the part as Photoshop guys why we have a job. But yeah, no, Scott's absolutely right.
Thank goodness, right?
And I can probably tell you, what I was at a workshop the other week. I was kind of tagging along to a workshop that a few buddies of mine were teaching. And in the beginning of the workshop, they asked everybody what people wanted to learn. And several people in the class all said, I want to learn like why when I take my photos, they don't look like the scenery that I'm out there photographing. Why when I get back to my computer, they look so different? And that's exactly why, guys. It's just your camera doesn't take it. So you're not the only one. If it happens to you, it happens to every other photography out there, every other photographer. You got
right.
it?
Right. Yeah. So here's the image.
Okay.
So this image that you see on screen, it looks like it looked to my eye because I could see the sculpture, the bust, and I could see the light on. I'm like, ooh, that light looks really great. Well, I go to take the picture, and your camera is going to give you one or two things. It's going to make the outside look good, right? It's going to make the what you see out the window, or it's going to make the bust look good, everything be really bright. It's just not going to do both. It's not you as a photographer.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you could try to spot meter it, and again, spot metering would make the bust look good.
Yeah.
But outside, it's going to be totally blown out. So how do you keep the outside and this object inside that are so far away in exposure to look good? There's this program called Lightroom, and it has a slider. So take a look on screen, and watch. I'm going to hit reset, so you will... That's what the camera took. And I had to make a decision. I thought, well, here's the thing. I'm going to make it look good out the window, because that's going to be a little harder to get back that much detail. And then I'm going to use Lightroom settings to get me back. So here's the after. Right? And basically, if you look at what it is, it's me moving up this slider right here, shadows. So the shadow slider basically is going to open up the shadows. Look, it opens them up.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not, shadows isn't enough by itself, right? So I'm going to bring up the contrast to make it look a little more contrasty. I'm surprised they didn't put any clarity on it because that will usually.
There you go.
Yeah, look at it, make it woo! So just those few sliders. And basically what it is, it opens up the shadows. And you really need to be able to open up those shadows. So that's it.
Cool.
All right, so back to the book real quick. We'll look at just a couple more images here. Let me go back to the book. By the way, when you make a book, you can save it as a book. And so that way when you click on this collection, it's the right images in the right order. This is another shot just in the Vatican of a statue, and I got up close with a wide-angle lens. And this is an interesting story on trying to get this picture of a nun. So this is where, can we talk a little bit about equipment?
Let's talk about gear.
All right.
And people are asking a lot about gear, too.
Okay, so yeah. So I want
to
go real quickly over the gear, and then I want to tell you about this particular shot, because it's one of my favorite shots from the whole day, and I want to tell you the frustration I had getting it. And I have some behind-the-scenes shots to show you my frustration in life. All right. First off, I try to travel with one lens. One lens, a 28-300. I think it's a do-it-all lens.
Mm-hmm.
Because can I tell you the most frustrating thing about travel photography is carrying a camera bag with extra lenses. Here's why. I guarantee you, this is an absolute guarantee, whatever lens that you have on your camera right then, it will always be the wrong lens for what you're standing in front of. You will spend your entire day changing lenses. You'll be swapping them out all day long. And now you're worried about your camera bag being stolen. And that's a very, very real worry. I talk about this on my tour about a couple of buddies that lost all their gear like that. People that were aware of it and were concerned about it, like, I better watch my gear, I better put it over here. And lost it like that. The people that steal camera gears don't just walk up and yank it off your shoulder. I mean, these are professionals that they do this every day, all day. It's their job. So when you have a camera bag, you're worried about that, and you'll always have the wrong lens on. If you have a 28 to 300, in that case, you've got it all covered. You've got the whole thing covered. You've got wide, you've got long. So normally I would be shooting on vacation with a Nikon, right? So I have the Nikon 28 to 300 lens right here. This Nikon lens is absolutely tack sharp. This is an amazingly wonderful lens. It's about $1,100, right? About $1,100. It's not cheap. So, but it's pretty lightweight. I mean, it's not super lightweight. You can see. It's not like, you know.
Yeah, it's...
But considering, it's not bad.
Lighter than the 70 to 200.
Absolutely.
But that doesn't mean a whole lot.
All right. So I took a Canon 5D Mark III, and I'll talk about that in just a moment. But this is... this is Canon's 28 to 300. This thing is a load, and it's a push-pull lens, too. It doesn't even turn. It's a push-pull. I can't actually push-pull. Yeah, it's a push-pull. This thing is a load, and it's $2,400.
And it's monstrous.
It's monstrous. So somebody told me on my tour, a guy come up and says, hey,
holy God,
Tamron has a 28 to 300. This has got to be half the weight of the Nikon, right? Because so Nikon has a great one.
Yeah.
Canon has a great one that's really expensive and heavy. Then there's Tamron. So Tamron has this lens. It's a 28 to 300. It is half the weight of the Nikon, one third of the weight of the Canon. It's $419. $419. Now, so I want to tell you the good and the bad about it, because I wrote about, hey, I'm taking this on my trip with me. So the good and the bad of it is this. The price is really good. For $419, it is an amazing lens. That's the end of the sentence. It's not an amazing lens in general. So for the money, it's great. You have this versatility.
It's not 29.
Are you sure?
Yes.
I looked it up
They have two different versions.
They have two different versions?
That's the 629.
Okay, this one, okay.
Breaking news.
Brad says it's 629. $629, right?
Yes.
You sure?
Still half
yes.
What?
What's the other version?
That has the VC, the other one.
Oh, this has the vibration control?
Yes.
So if you get it without the vibration control, it's...
47, whatever.
Yeah. If you get it without the vibration control, it's $419. Does this one have the vibration control?
Yes.
Does. Six what?
29.
629, okay.
I'm going to link in the chat.
Thank you. Brad's going to put a link in the chat. So what this lens is it's good for the money.
Mm-hmm.
Where the Nikon lens, which is $1,100, is an amazing lens, period. This is great for the money. So if you're like, I want to get that, but I'm not going to spend $1,100 on a lens, this works pretty good. I can tell you what doesn't work good. It's really, really good at wide angle. I have it on screen. I can show you a comparison between a Canon 16-35, right, which is an expensive lens, $1,700, and this one. So I actually have a shot here. I took, again, now this was taken on a tripod, so I could just switch out the lens. The images are right there, yeah, right here. Oh, I'm in the wrong place, hold on. Where did I put that? Did I write the word lens? Lenses, there we go. Here we go, let's go to the develop module so you can see them. All right, so this one is the Tamron at 24 millimeter. This is the Canon at 24 millimeter. But of course you're gonna say, oh, well you're zoomed out, you can't tell. Let's zoom way in. Let's zoom in, super zoom. In fact, let's go to compare mode. How's this? We put two lenses side by side, right? And we can zoom in here by holding the shift key, I believe. So, Tamron on the left, Canon on the right. Look at that. So when you are at 24, as wide as it'll go, that's pretty darn good.
Yeah.
However, when you leave 24, it goes downhill from there. So when you get further and further out, it gets softer and softer. But I used it for most of the trip. So most of the images you're gonna see today were taken with that because, and here's why. So I took with me, I never used this lens before, and I didn't want to just go, I'm going to go to the Vatican, and I'm going to take this lens, and if I hate it, I'm stuck. So I took a Canon 16-35, and I took a Canon 70-200. just in case. And so I
went, which is about the size of this.
Which is the size of that. And the 16 to 35, they're both serious, expensive, great, amazing. Canon glass is
insane. They're professional lenses.
They are professional lenses. So I took them with me, and I didn't take this to the Vatican, right? So the Vatican pictures were not taken with that nice lens. But here's what happened, and I want to go back to that other shot. So let's go to the book, back to the book, and to the book module. So this shot of the nun here. So I'm there, and I have the 16 to 35, because I'm shooting these amazing ceilings. Like, wow, these ceilings are incredible. Then I look over, and I see two nuns in beautiful light. And what do I have? A 16 to 35. They might as well have been 1,200 feet away, because they're like behind a barrier, and they're praying in this little church area inside this massive basilica. And I'm like, so my wife is holding the 70 to 200. And of course, I'm standing there, I'm like, oh my gosh, the light's perfect, the nuns, and there's nobody around the nuns. It's pretty cool. I mean, there's a couple people. So I run over to my wife, honey, give me the 70 to 200. She reaches in her purse, hands it to me. Hold on. Hold my lens in my mouth and all. It's ridiculous. So I put it on and I go running back, and now people have moved, they've shifted, and now I'm trying to move around the room to try to find a good shot, because you know what, here's what it is. There's tourists in there too.
Yeah.
There's all kinds of tourists. There's people walking around, and I was completely out of luck with a 16 to 35. And of course, by the time I got the 70 to 200 on, she had moved. So I just basically had to sit there and wait, shooting at a high ISO, bang, 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 until I got this shot. But I brought you the sequence, so you can see how frustrating it was. So let's just start off. Let's go to the grid here. Hold on. So here we are. Let me zoom out. All right. So you can see, this is what messes up pictures. This stuff here.
Really, the colorful hat, I don't know.
And the light's pretty bright on them as well. So I'm running around trying, now this is after I switch lenses.
Her backpack is nice too.
Oh, that was the other problem. So my wife's like, honey, stand right here. And I'm like, you know what, it doesn't look good to see a Costco backpack on your nun right there. So I'm trying to find a way to minimize that. But when you try to minimize it and zoom in tighter, now you've got this hat. And look, she's moved positions. Like, now I notice you're shooting the nuns. Let me get in front of them. So now I'm trying to find different areas around, and there's people getting up and move. I know.
Light's getting cool.
Close. The light's getting better. And watch, if you go like this, she's dancing. Okay, and then let's go a little further. People walking in front of me. People come up with red shirts. I mean, it's you just have to, in this case, you just have to wait it out. Wait it out. Now I'm getting close, and I'm trying there we go.
Ooh.
To be able to get that one shot. And I'm trying to get distracting stuff. There's with a little vignette on it. And then her friends get ready to leave. Oh, when her friend leaves, I could see she was getting ready. Ooh, look, her friend's almost gone. Her friend's gone. And so, you know, I think that was probably the one that made it. Maybe we'll see one that's been adjusted. But that's how many shots it took to get to that point.
Yeah.
And I'll talk more about
the
gear.
You gotta work it.
Yeah, I wanna talk about the strap and the camera and some other stuff when we get back. But that was one of those things where, of course, I had the wrong lens on. And by the way, that was the last time I did the lens switching thing. That was it. I said, I don't care.
I'm done with it.
That the Tamron, there's one other thing about the Tamron before we take a break. And you're going to need to know this, is it does have chromatic aberration, the most chromatic aberration I've ever seen, ever on a lens. However, I will show you after the break, one click to get rid of it. So as long as you have Lightroom, especially if you have Lightroom 5, it is amazingly easy, literally. But I just want to let you know, if you get this lens for $629, it has chromatic aberration. Do we care?
No.
No, because it's one click to get rid of it. Just like, if it's not the sharpest lens in the world, what are we going to do?
Sharpen it.
We're going to sharpen it. So that's okay. So, you know, it's not a killer lens. It's a killer lens for the money. I liked it a lot better when I thought it was $419. I like it maybe not quite as much as
when a lens has four in front of it. It's
yeah, like 400, I'm like, you know, that's like, you know. Okay.
Hey, before we get, you mentioned Lightroom 5. I saw a question there. Somebody said, I have Lightroom 3 or Lightroom 4. Is it worth it to upgrade to Lightroom 5? Yes.
Oh, from
$79 bucks.
From 3? Hands down, absolutely, because they have new math that makes it better. From 4, it's better.
There's
new stuff. The tilt, the up.
The upright, but I would say they could have just given a cloning healing plugin.
Oh,
and
yeah.
I would have paid $79.
I would have paid $79.
Yeah,
you're right. He's right.
So,
buy
yeah,
it.
It's something. All right, guys, we're going to take a very, very quick break. Make sure you're posting into the little comment chat room thing there if you want to get entered to win our prizes, and we'll see you back here in just a minute.
Here at Kelby Training, we have hundreds of classes and thousands of lessons on all kinds of photography techniques, from beginners to advanced. But if you're just starting out, maybe unboxing your first DSLR, you may not have a clue where to begin. What if you had an opportunity to learn from world-class photography instructors exactly what you need to get started? From the very beginning, with help all along the way, Kelby Training now can give you just that. We're launching an innovative new tool for beginners called Beginner Start Here. It'll lay the foundation needed to understand your camera and walk you through how to capture beautiful images. And the best part is, all you have to do is tell us a little about yourself, such as your camera manufacturer, your DSLR model, and what you're interested in. And we'll design a custom curriculum to help you take your photography to the next level. It's the perfect way to learn at your own pace, on your own time. Plus, with a subscription, you get access to our online training wherever you are, so you can replay specific clips or even repeat the entire class if you'd like. We'll take you step by step, right through the process, so you can start taking good images in no time. And as you grow, we have a huge library of classes on all different kinds of photography techniques that can help you take your photography beyond the basics. So if you're just starting out and itching to turn that mode dial to something other than auto, then this is for you. And we're passionate about teaching you how, every step of the way. Start here at KelbyTraining.com.
All right, we are back live here with Scott Kelby and a webcast, A Walk in Rome. All right, a couple of quick giveaways here. So we have
A giveaway. Yes, of Kelby Training, a year of Kelby Training.
One year of Kelby Training.
Full year for free.
And we will post the name there in just a second. And also we have, and you just saw the offer go up on the bottom, about $20 off as well. So
yeah, so if you're watching this, you get a deal too? $20 off for a whole year.
Off 1 year subscription to Kelby Training.
Cool. So can we talk about more equipment?
Let's talk about we got it.
All right, I use this strap. I use a black rapid strap. It basically goes, you know, over your head. Goes around your shoulder, and then you attach the camera to here. Why I love this is nobody can grab it and run. It is kind of a safety issue in that if it's over your shoulder, somebody can actually grab it and run. Mm-hmm. And they do that. Usually young kids will come by and just grab it right off your shoulder. This thing screws into the bottom, and this doesn't look very pretty on me right now, but then it hangs at your side. So when you want to get a shot, think about this. Something cool happens. You don't have to take it off your shoulder and bring it up. You just reach down and it comes right to your eye. So you can shoot super fast. I use this for football. This is my second body thing, but I learned about it on one of my photo walks years ago, and I've been using one ever since. So
and
I
you take got your this, hands free.
Right. I take this with me. All right.
Okay.
And the body I used, it was my first time really spending any time with it. This is a Canon 5D Mark III. And it's a wonderful camera. I actually use this on my tour. On my shoot like a pro tour, but we just do a photo shoot the last 15 minutes maybe, so I don't really get to do anything. You know, it's like it's you'll set it manual and make a couple of shots.
Yeah,
with
put
flash.
It through spaces.
But I haven't really. That was my first chance to. So on the plane, I'm kind of learning it as I go. So I hadn't spent that much time with it.
All right, so I'm gonna ask.
Okay.
You used to have a lot of Nikon gear. You used to shoot a lot of Nikon.
I still have a lot of Nikon.
You used to shoot a lot of Nikon.
Yeah.
And mm-hmm. and you're shooting Canon. Right. A lot these days.
Okay, well, so, just to give you a little background. Okay, so Canon came to us a number of months ago and said, hey, we'd like to work with you guys and do some things. And we said, well, we've got this worldwide photo walk coming up. And they said, hey, we'd love to be a sponsor. By the way, they gave away. Well, they haven't given away yet. Someone's going to win.
But the winner.
Canon 70D. The runners up are getting pro printers. They're getting the Canon really stepped up in a huge way to help us sponsor the Worldwide Photo Walk, which is a free event, and that's why we have to have sponsors because it's incredibly expensive to put it on. And Canon said, "Hey, let us be the camera sponsor. We'll step up." So we started working with Canon and started making friends, and we're talking to these guys. And one day I'm in a meeting with a buddy of mine who works for Canon, and he goes, "You shoot football, right?" I'm like, "Yeah, I shoot NFL every weekend." He's like, "You want to try out some of our gear?" Now, Canon makes the 1DX, right, which is, you know, there's no sports photographer that you say, want to try 1DX, that they're not going to go,
no,
I'm just not interested. No, they're going to be, of course. I was like, Well, of course, you know, because ever since it came out, you know, it kind of like, you know, it was the big daddy of all sports cameras. But, you know, I never really got to use it. So I said, man, I would love to. So, they said, well, we'll send you a lens to try and some and a body or two. And so so I tried it. And I completely switched for sports. I'm all the way over there. This is my, I'm just using the 5D now. So, you know, I'm still trying it out. And it's great. It did wonderfully well. I'll talk about that in a second. But that was it. I shot with that 1DX. For sports, and I know this isn't about sports, so I don't want to go into it, but...
But and that's the high frame rate, high, super high ISO camera.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the
We're at Photoshop World. Brad takes a photo. This is the honest and goodness truth. Brad takes a photo with me. He takes my camera, because I always steal my camera. Takes it, and he shows me a picture on screen and says, what do you think of this? I went, looks good. He goes, what ISO do you think of that? Now, when someone asks you what ISO, you know it's a trick question.
Yeah, it's awesome.
So I go, 6,400. He says, 20,300. 20,800, excuse me. 20,800, and I'm like, you are kidding me. 20, I mean, it's like you didn't even see noise.
Yeah.
So now, if you blow it up to 100%, a size that no one will ever see, you see some noise. But it was unbelievable, full screen size on his laptop, and you don't see any noise. So the noise is incredible. I mean, I need to do a whole show just on the 1DX, so I'm not gonna go into that. But so that's why. So they let me use this equipment, and I'm just loving it. I mean, for sports people, So anyway, so this was my first time trying it. I was surprised. I don't hear people talking about how good the noise is. The noise is great. I'm shooting it 1600, 2000, 2400. The whole time because
on the 5D.
On the 5D Mark III. And it's fantastic. And I know people rave about the video. I don't shoot much video yet, so but this is an incredible camera. I mean the images that come out of it are just wonderful. I loved it. I still don't know everything about it. I'm still learning stuff, but it's just insane. But so that's what I used. You know what else too? It doesn't have a battery grip and all. I didn't want to go, you know, this is all I had. This is me.
Well yeah, that's
one thing. So for the rest of the trip after I left the Vatican, this was my rig. Tamron lens, chromatic aberration generator, and this. But hey, I'll show you what to do to get rid of chromatic aberrations. Just, I don't think this photo has any, but we'll zoom in. Oh yeah, it does. Look.
Oh yeah, dude.
Yeah, look at the green.
Perfect.
Look at the green. Oh, look, can I zoom in any further?
So it wasn't.
See that green? That's not, believe it or not, that's not on the building.
It wasn't painted green?
It's not. And see
and
this
it wasn't
purple?
Painted purple
no,
on the edge there?
This is weird. The Pantheon is not actually green and purple. That is what chromatic aberration is.
Yeah.
All right? And so they actually have a way to get rid of chromatic, thankfully. Let's zoom back into where I was. I don't even know where I was here. Let's go back up here to the world of chromatic aberrations. All right? You're going to go down here to the lens correction, right? And they have a thing called color. Is something wrong? Okay, there's a lot of like movement in the studio here. So look, you click on color, right? And they have this thing called defringe, right? And you can take away the purple. Look, boom, gone. See? Right? Or the green by moving these sliders. Now, if it doesn't take it away right away, then you have to figure out where that green, ooh, there it is, right there, the green hue is. Takes you 2 seconds. I mean, boom, look at that.
What happens if you just click the checkbox?
Oh, it does it automatically.
Well, I wanted to say, like, for the manual.
That's manual, right. Sorry. Look, purple and green, gone.
And if the checkbox doesn't do it.
If the checkbox doesn't do anything, I'm sorry I even brought that up. I was just looking at the sliders where they were and stuff. Okay, so anyway, if you own this lens, you have a step two.
But I think the good thing, it doesn't do a thing to the photo.
No,
it's not like it degraded the photo. The photo's not any less sharper.
Oh, the photo was degraded anyway. No.
The photo's not any less sharper, so.
All right, hey, I want to do, I'll show you, I'm going to rip through the book because we're almost out of time. I'm going to kind of rip through there, but I want to show you a couple tutorials and some things, some post-processing, and then we'll wrap things up. So I'm just going to zip back to the book here, and we'll just rip you through here as quick as I can. You're going to see some more, of course, Sistine Chapel shots because, well, you know, you just can't say no. This is a two-page spread, and Lightroom lets you do those very easily. A couple more, you know, after a while, you're like, okay, no more shots of the dome. But this is all stuff in the Vatican, not surprisingly. This is probably my favorite shot from the whole trip. Mm-hmm. So we went to the Trevi Fountain late at night. We went there after 12 midnight thinking, well, there'll be nobody there. It's a Monday night, you know, literally a Monday night. Yeah. And it's like 12:30 at night. And there was only like 250 people gathered around the Trevi Fountain. Literally hundreds of people, 12:30 at night. When we finally left at 1:30 at night, maybe down to 80 people, but they're all standing right in front of the fountain, so you cannot get a picture from straight in front. So, we're waiting for a cab, and we're waiting there, and it had been just sprinkling a little bit, and I took my tripod, I splayed out the legs, I put it really, really down low, and got this. This guy was basically putting his shop up for the night. You know, he's packing up all the fruit and stuff.
That's cool.
And I just like the shot. It doesn't scream Rome. Right? It doesn't say, oh, that's Roma, via Roma. No, it's just kind of a... But that's probably my favorite shot. I love the reflections in the wet
ground
street.
Makes it, yeah.
And this is when I tell people, go out early in the morning. Because early in the morning, chances are, things are still going to be damp. You get those, wet rocks and stuff. So I talk about that a lot. There's just a couple more shots just in the Pantheon and stuff. So here are the Trevi Fountains. And these shots are actually larger. You can see the... Well, you can. If I just click, you'll actually... But I'm trying to make them two-page spread, so you have to kind of make a choice of, do you want to see more fountain?
Mm-hmm.
You don't want to just show the roof.
Yeah.
So I split the difference here. But so how do you get a shot like this or this when there's just tons and tons of people around, right? So the trick is this, patience. So I literally sat there, there's 250 people there. I splay the legs out on my tripod. By the way, the tripod I use is this one. This is a Gitzo Traveler. A cheaper alternative would be the Oben. Oben makes a Traveler that's probably half the price, but it's carbon fiber, and I splay the legs out as far as I can. So this is not splaying them. Splaying them is when you pull this little thing and splay them.
Is that the official term?
Splaying.
Splay, wow.
Splay, S-P-L-A-Y.
I never knew that.
Did you really know?
No, you got a word of the day calendar.
Word of the day, yeah. Well, that's a photography word of the day. That's not a bad idea, make a photography
word of the day.
Okay, so we splay them way out. So I get them way out there.
Got some
and I sit there. Now I've got cable release, a plunger from Dynamite. I have a cable release, and there's people walking everywhere. And what happens is you're standing in front of the fountains, and two people walking right posted in the middle. They move, another two come up, another two, four, group of six, group of eight. And I'm just sitting there, and I'm just waiting. And you know what happens? It kind of drives you nuts because you're waiting, and then you think, here, it's almost
it's
clear.
Happen.
It's almost clear, and then people come from the other side. And you think, you wait. Oh, here comes some more. Oops, as soon as this couple's done, I got it. And as they're moving away, another couple moves in. But son of a gun, if at some point I went and I got probably 10 shots, click, where there's nobody in front from this one angle.
Yeah.
And so, I guess you'll see a couple more. There's another one from a different angle. Could not get rid of the Italian police cars in the background. But you'll see maybe a couple more here. And these are just some shots taken during my photo walk as we're cruising around. A wonderful woman, Ashley Turnsley, I think is her name, helped me with my walk. And she got us access. She got the custodian to open this church for us. Mm-hmm. So this is a beautiful church. And this is where I took those, the comparing the canon and the other one.
Yeah.
And just a gorgeous little church
up on the
there.
Left.
And here's the courtyard outside the church. So I was just inside those doors taking that shot. Very small church. I mean, you can see it's got five pews there. And these are some shots out of the Vatican window. These are taken on my photo walk. We're walking by a little fruit market, and I got this little shot over here. And here's the hallway from that church you just saw. And this is also on my photo walk, a little churchy here.
Is that with the 28 to 300?
These are all the 28 to 300 now.
So yeah, background blur and everything?
Yeah, if it's not a Vatican shot, it's with the 28 to 300. These are all 28 to 300. Little pizza, hey! This was interesting. So you have to be careful how you shoot the Colosseum. And I talk about this on my tour, and I always say the exact same thing. Wherever you're going in Europe, it is an absolute lock that it's under restoration. And I say, so don't plan a day trip to somebody without checking. Can I show you some pictures? I brought some. Let's go to the develop module and let's take a look. Here's the Colosseum.
Oh, that's pretty.
Yeah. This is the side you want to take the picture from. Yeah. It's nice, huh?
You're not kidding, dude. When you said scaffolding, I thought...
Yeah, dude.
I thought you'd see a couple of planks of scaffolding.
Dude, we are talking major scaffolding. How about up front?
Dude.
Yeah, right there, right in front of
that. Oh, wow. I had no idea. When you said scaffolding, I had no idea you meant to this
dude,
level.
Dude, everywhere different places. Scaffolding. This is inside the Vatican. Hey, I'm going to shoot that courtyard. No, you're not.
When you said scaffolding, I'm thinking, well, maybe you could have cloned some of it out or something like that.
Yeah, well, we'll talk about that in just a minute. But, yeah, you're not cloning this scaffolding out, bro.
No.
But I mean, this is the typical stuff wherever you go in the world, whatever. So that's why I tell people the first day you're there, get on a double-decker bus. And we did it. We did the exact same thing. Hop on, hop off bus, go on a tour all the way around the city. You'll find places that you thought you wanted to go at dawn, and you're going to go, yeah. I'm not getting up at 5 a.m. to shoot that. That's just typical of the kind of stuff that you find. Let me whip back through the book because I don't want to run too much longer here. But I got a couple of little tutorials that I do want to show you. So I got a couple of shots here. So what you have to do here is this is what I had to do. I shoot way up high because there are tourists everywhere. So one side is filled with scaffolding. The other side is absolutely completely filled with tourists. Let me give you an idea here. Like that. Just tourist city. And you're not cloning them out, folks. Okay. Now, there's a trick you can use. All right? There's a trick you can use in Photoshop. If you used a tripod, you could do it handheld, I guess, too, but if you use a tripod, what it requires you to do is stand in one place and shoot a photograph every 10 to 15 seconds. And you're gonna shoot 10 or 12, so it takes you a couple of minutes to do it. It's ideal to do it on a tripod. And then you're gonna let Photoshop analyze these. And I'll show you, now these shots are not from Rome, but I did this in Miami. I was down there for my seminar. Look at all these people walking in front, right? This is the Versace Mansion down in Miami. I did have my tripod, this very same tripod. I did not have to splay the legs. Anyway, so here's what we're gonna do. I'm gonna select all of these photos of people walking in front of there. Look, even a car down here, right? And we'll open them all in Photoshop, okay? All at once, here we go. We're gonna open them all in Photoshop and I will show you the trick. It's gonna take a moment to open these, but here they go. Oh, not, I guess not. There they are. Woo, that was fast. Okay. Now, here's what you're going to do. Once they're all open in Photoshop, and it's all these different documents, and you can see there's people ruining my lovely shot everywhere. Go under the file menu, under scripts, and choose statistics. It's so obvious.
Yeah.
All right, you're going to choose statistics.
Elements has it, but it's called tourist removal.
Yeah, there you go. That's a good name for it. You're going to choose the stack mode of median. You're going to open up your open file. So add your open files. You click OK, you wait, and it analyzes, and it's trying to find the difference between photos. And as people are walking, they're moving, there's a difference. And watch. They're gone. Is that amazing?
It's awesome.
But the problem is you have to literally... No, here's what the problem is. Let me just close all the pictures now. The problem is... Sorry, it's just going to take a second. People have to be moving. So why couldn't I try this at the Trevi Fountains? Because people sit on the steps and they sit. They don't move. The key to this move working is tourists have to move.
Yeah.
If they sit and they camp out, you're sunk. All right.
And there were carts and everything in that other photo, the Colosseum.
Right.
There were carts
yeah.
and things that were probably weren't going
right.
anywhere.
So anyway, let's go back to we'll jump back to the book real quick. Ah, the book.
Hey, real quick, we have our subscription winner, Florian.
Yeah, Florian is our subscription winner, and if you didn't win the subscription, of course, you could still get $20.
Yep.
$20 off. All right. Okay, let's look at just a couple more shots here. These are, one of the things I shoot a lot is color. Just things for, color. Here, when I always try to think, so what are the things that I think of when I think of Rome? I think of fashion.
Mm-hmm.
So these shots are taken through a store window. I took off, watch. Can you jump back to me? Take off the lens hood and just put the lens right on the glass. And that way, it doesn't pick up any reflection and you can shoot right through a store window, no problem, and it's right on. So I was able to do that and get these little shots because I wanted to show some, something fashion. This is on top of the thing they call the typewriter, which you're gonna see in just a moment. I think one of the most amazing things
go back really quick. There you go. And one didn't pull up in time.
Okay.
So that's on top of the typewriter.
That's on top of the typewriter. The food. I always want to shoot the food. I think it's fascinating. It's interesting. This is just outside my hotel. Just a snapshot here. A couple little things of color. This is a restaurant. I'm teaching in Dallas, and a guy comes up to me and says, Scott, you got to go to this restaurant. You're going to Rome. I heard you say you're going to Rome. You got to go to this restaurant called Mimi Acoco. M-I-M-I-E Acoco. Mimi Acoco. And he says, it's unbelievable. My wife and I go to Rome every year, and we eat there all the time. It was the most unbelievable restaurant. We went back 2 times.
Really?
Yeah, I took my brother and his girlfriend back. So, this is some shots. These are just taken while we're waiting for our meal. And that's taken with the 20, the Tamron, but it's using the high ISO of the 5D Mark III, and you don't see any, no noise reduction on any of this.
When you say high, like how high are we talking?
Probably 2,000. Well, you know what we can actually see, right? Let's go to the develop module.
These days, that's not even considered
that's 16. High. That's 1,600.
Yeah.
Right? Wow. 1,600, 16, they're all 1,600. So you don't even see any noise at 1,600, right?
No.
So yeah, it's amazing. All right, these are some other shots just, you know, around the Vatican. See this shot right here? I'll just show you real quickly what it really looks like. Let's go to the develop module. Why do I keep clicking there? I'm sorry. If I go to the, here. Oh, where did I stick that photo? You're killing me.
This could be one of those times where I talk again.
Nah, I was going to show you how to get, oh wait, I have a folder. Oh, here we go. I, of course, had another folder called Room Talk.
There's
the gift shop. Now, there's nobody there now. In about an hour, there'll be about 400 people pouring down there. But yeah, that's in the gift shop. See, like
the, I'm telling you, you know what, dude? The private tour thing is, that's a great idea.
Yeah. So here's this shot. But this shot, of course, now look out the window, right? How did I get the window and this exposed? Well, let's look at the original.
Must be some fancy camera setting. Oh,
not a fancy camera setting. It was, let's just undo that. You can see the settings right here. We are pumping up the shadows. I pull back the highlights because the sky, watch the sky.
Oh,
the sky was blown out. Look what the highlights do. Now, anyone that's watching this has Lightroom 3. It doesn't work like that in Lightroom 3.
Yeah.
Right? It would look funky. It would look HDR'd. All right? I brought up the clarity. That's bringing out the detail. Look at the clarity, what the clarity does.
You don't even have a highlight slider in Lightroom. It's called recovery.
Recovery, right. Yeah, it doesn't add, you know, to the highlights. It only takes away. I brought up the vibrance a little. So here's as shot, and I just made it a little warmer. That's pretty much it. I didn't even touch the exposure or contrast. But anyway, just, you know, some of these things,
yeah.
You're overcoming things. It's not like you're a bad photographer, your camera's bad or anything. It's overcoming stuff that you can't overcome. We don't have much more. I got to wrap this up. I want to go through a few of the last pages here. This is the typewriter. This was the photo I spent the most time retouching, and I'll get a chance to show you maybe in a minute, and I don't need a ad there. Thank you. These are just some color. For shooting the food, I always, you know, if you look in a travel magazine, this is one of the things they talk about the most. It's one of the reasons why people love to travel to new places is to try the food. Mm-hmm. And these are shot with a 70 to 300. I'm just zoomed in tight and shoot wide open. So I'm at, you know, can I tell you one more thing about this lens? So it is a 3.5, which means when you're at wide angle, it's 3.5. The Nikon goes to f5.6. Right?
3.5 to 5.6.
3.5 to 5.6. I believe the Canon, I think it's the same all the way through, isn't it, Brad?
Probably.
Like
fixed.
One f-stop is f4, isn't it? No?
Take off the lens hood.
Take off the lens hood there.
This one is, 3.5 to 5.6?
Right. This one is 6.3. So when you zoom out to 300, it makes your f-stop, your widest open f-stop is 6.3. But these were taken at 6.3. They still look pretty good.
Yeah.
All right. And then here's there's another one of my favorite shots here, the guy on the left on the cell phone. By the way, everybody you shoot in Italy, every single person, I don't care what they're doing, unless they're praying and they're a nun, is on a cell phone. Everybody is on a cell phone. You can't get a picture of anybody that is not on a cell phone. I don't care whether they're working. I don't care whether they're policemen. Whoever it is, they were. Chief asked, were there any places that you want to shoot but you weren't allowed to? Yeah, like the Vatican, most churches, you know, they'll let you shoot just not on a tripod. But yeah, no, nobody ever restricted us any place that, except you are forbidden to shoot in the Sistine Chapel. You are absolutely forbidden to take out your camera, to use a cell phone, to do anything inside the Sistine Chapel.
Really?
Where Michelangelo's thing is. A Japanese company came in and they restored it 2 years ago. And one of their rules is we don't want to have to redo this restoration again. And we think flashes going off and stuff are going to affect it. This is the story I was told. So you are, and then there are guards in there. And if they see you, they will. What I've been told, because our guide warned us, they will make you delete the things from your camera.
Huh.
And here's the thing: is in the United States you can go, I ain't deleting crap. In Italy, they'll just throw you in jail. They're just like, really? Bang. Okay.
Wow.
I know. So here's just a couple of shots of the Vatican, the Dome of the Vatican, St. Peter's, you know. A couple little shots here, taken around town. This one on the right I want to talk to you about. I have a little tutorial to show you on this real quick. This is the Vatican taken at night, and I did not have my tripod. So what I tried to do was I take my camera, and there's a railing, and I'm trying to lay my camera on top. Pardon me. And the shot comes out crooked, but at least it's sharp. Now, I took 6 or 7 shots of this. Pardon me. 6 or 7 shots of this. Oh, there's water. I never knew there was water. 6 or 7 shots of this, and they're all out of focus. But this one. Because I went, goose, 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 goose. I turned on high speed continuous. In this case, I got this one. However, the shot's crooked. You know what the problem is? When you have, look how close the cross is to the top of the image, right? So I'll show you what the problem was straight up. So when I go to this image, in the develop module, look how crooked it is. So now I go to straighten it, right? I go to the crop tool.
Yeah.
And I think, well, I'll have to crop it in a little bit and then, you know, rotate it around to where it's straight. Well, where I get it where it's exactly pretty much straight.
You cut the cross there, off.
No, the cross is still there, but there is a 1/32 of an inch left over at the top, right? So it looks terrible. You've cropped it way too tight. It's still not exactly. So here's what I would do. I'm going to press Command E and it's going to jump over to Photoshop. I got a great trick for this. It really works really wonderfully well. So what you're going to do is this. You're going to select, you're going to add about an inch of space. So let's go to here and add 1 inch to the height of our image, right? 1 inch. Now, if I just take this and I select an inch here, because this is what we're going to do, and I make a copy of that, I press Command J, and I drag it up here, you're going to see a line. I don't know if you can see it on your little screen there, but you're going to see a line where it doesn't exactly match. And this happens anytime you extend a canvas. You can't see on this screen very well, but you'll see a little line.
Yeah, because you're like taking a portion of the sky and putting it above itself.
Right, well, and it's dark. If the sky's one solid color, it's not. But it's darker on the edges, there's a little bit of vignetting, and then it comes in, and it just looks funky. The trick is this, and it works like a charm. Go to Free Transform, right-click, and say Flip Vertical. Now it flips vertical, and it perfectly lines up. The sky's perfect.
Because part of the sky is with itself.
Right,
now.
Right. And I didn't make a great selection here, so I'm going to cheat. So now all you have to do is go get rid of that little extra part of the Vatican, that or St. Peter's, that doesn't really exist. So what you can do is go in here with the, I want to show you how the problem and the fix, with the patch tool, and I'm going to get rid of this. I'm going to select just that, and if I drag it over to one side or the other, it smears, right? Mm-hmm. However, if you go and instead of normal, this was new in CS6, content aware, when you drag it now, it's gone.
Nobody knows that's there.
Nobody knows that's there.
It's like a super secret.
Like one of the best. That's the super secret Photoshop tip of the night.
Yes.
When you switch from patch normal to patch content aware, it's super secret. All right, so that was...
David asked, why not use the content aware fill tool? That's exactly what...
Yeah, it is a version of it.
It is a version, and it's sometimes, in a way, a better version.
Yeah, because sometimes the content aware fill tool can smear, too, depending on how...
And with content aware, you can't tell it what you want to fix it from.
Right.
With the patch tool, so you're saying, I want you to fix this, but take it from here.
All right. This is still a little crooked now, so I could straighten it. But now I can straighten it and recrop it. And
now
look.
You got room.
I got plenty of room. Looks okay. So that was something I had to do to fix that. Now, just jumping back to the book real quick, because the book's almost done. Thank goodness. It's taken us a while. Let's go to the book again. So we're eating. We're cruising around, and there's the last shot of the book. That is from the same bridge where I took the other one. I zoomed into 300. I mean, picture this at night, right?
Yeah.
It's 6.3 in the lens.
Click.
I'm holding it, you know, so anyway. But these are all handheld because I forgot my tripod that night. We were going to go back to the room and get it, and we didn't, and, you know.
But if you could find a wall, and, I mean.
Yeah, I found a wall and kind of steadied it. It wasn't great, but it was as good as I could do. There were a couple of last little things that I wanted to show you. One was another fix I wanted to show you real quick. Let me just see what we got here. This one. So unfortunately, a lot of times you're shooting very bald skies. And I have a pretty standard thing that I do. Look at what it originally looked like.
Oh, yeah.
Look how flat that was. Now look at the finished one. And you can see what I did, basically. I raised the contrast a little, but there's a trick that we use. If the sky looks bad, if it's too bright, we bring down the highlights. Look at what just the highlight slider alone does for this photo watch. Look how it clamped down that sky.
Mm-hmm.
That made the biggest difference right there. Of course, clarity. When do we use the clarity slider? We use it when there's texture. Anytime you want to enhance texture, that's why you don't use clarity on like pictures of babies or brides, or because it looks. Eh. But on a stone building, this thing, it might as well just say, you know what that says in Latin? It actually says add clarity. That's clarity summongous. Okay. I brought up the vibrance a little so the color was better. Look at the sky, it's a little gray. Bring up the vibrance, it's a little blue.
Yeah.
And pretty much that's it. You know, I didn't do much with exposure or contrast or whites or blacks.
Can you put your highlights back up to zero really quick?
Yeah.
Because I think that's worth showing people. Look at your histogram. So many people freak out over their histogram on their camera. That's blinking at them. They're like, oh my God, I got a meter. My something's, you know?
Yeah.
Look at what you regained.
Yeah. Boom. And you don't even have to go that far to get rid of the clipping.
No.
Right there. All right. So anyway, I just wanted to show you that one. And we've run over time, of course. This is the photo I had to do the most to. And I'll wrap up with this tutorial. Mike says, what's the difference between clarity and sharpening? Mike, clarity is, it enhances mid-tone contrast, all right? And it kind of looks like almost a tonal contrast effect when you pull it up. Sharpening makes the image sharper. So that's the difference.
Yeah.
It almost looks like you're sharpening sometimes when you use clarity, because the image can now look more contrasty, but it is enhancing mid-tone contrast. This is the picture that I had to do the most work on. I want to show you it in the book. Do I have it in the book? Yeah, I got it in the book. Hold on. Then, because that's the before picture. The after picture is right there. So this is the after picture. So I won't be able to give you the full tutorial on how I did it because literally I spent 45 minutes to an hour on this one. And that's what I'm a 10 minute guy.
Yeah.
If I got 10 minutes into a shot, that at that point I'm like, I'm done. This one was probably an hour, and I'll show you why. And it's heartbreaking on some level. First, there is scaffolding.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Look, what else is there? Purple, chromatic aberration. Oh, you can't see it on your screen. It's a chromatic aberration fiesta.
You can see it around the statue, too.
Yeah, there's chromatic. So we know how to get rid of that, right? But this is the before picture, before I've done that. But what I wanted to show you was, do I have this here? I wanted to show you if I have it. I thought I grabbed it, but maybe I didn't. Oh, here it is. Oh, is this the one? This is what that shot looks like when you take it. So when you're there, you're looking at the thing called the typewriter, and you're seeing every car, every tour bus, everything.
Yeah.
But did you notice you didn't see any in my shot?
No.
Do you know why? Camera trick, not Photoshop. No, camera trick.
All right.
That's taken from a standing position. See the grass in front? I put my camera literally down on the ground, and all that stuff's gone.
Dude!
Right? I got it down on the ground and tipped it up a little bit. Now, you have to realize, I'm literally shooting blind. I'm reaching through a wrought iron fence. So my camera is, there's a short little fence so you don't walk on the grass. I'm reaching through it. And I'm taking a shot, and I look on the back, and I see it's crooked. And I take another shot, and it's still kind of crooked. And I move it a little, and I move it up a little
bit. That's why LCDs are great.
Yep.
Live view.
Yeah. Click. Well, I use live view to get me close, and I turned it off.
Yeah.
So then I click, click, click. Now, so that got me at least this shot. And I'm showing my wife, and she's doing the same thing. So now watch. I take it over to Photoshop. Now, please don't tell anybody to do this. It'll have to be our secret of what I did here. Because it's I'm not proud of it. Here we go.
They won't tell anybody.
See, this side looks great. That side looks bad. We're going to take this and put it up on its own layer. Now, we need to add a little space. So we'll go and add maybe 2 inches to the width. But just on the left side. Then we're going to take that little piece over here and flip horizontal. And we're gonna see where that is. And one of the tricks is to lower the opacity so you can see through. That way, I can line it right up. Like that. Now you can see that the perspective is a little different on that side, right? Just a little bit different?
Yeah.
So I'm just gonna grab it and drag it out. Eek! Now you're thinking, oh, that's cheating. You bet your butt it is. Now, I get it close. I kind of, now I'm nudging it with the arrow keys on my keyboard, nudging it up, nudging it down. Then I'm gonna add a layer mask, and I'm gonna erase the parts I don't want. So I added a layer mask, it's in white, so I'm gonna paint in black with a soft brush, and I'm gonna, we gotta put the opacity back up to 100%. And then I'm gonna erase these areas that I don't really need, right? This stuff over here, well, I wanna keep a little of that sky. I'll back off a little so you guys can see better. So we don't wanna see that up there, right? We don't wanna see that. Actually, I do want to see a little bit of that, don't I? There we go. And then I'm going to go over here and make sure we don't see that. Let's paint that back in, and voila. Now it's just a recrop.
Yeah.
And you have to do a little more work with it. Like, I would brighten it. I would go actually here and brighten that up just a little bit, right, to, you know, get it to match. I mean, I did a little tweaking with it.
And you can play with the patch tool and things like that to fix a little spot.
The other thing that I had to do was, look how the hedge is all trimmed here, and then it gets, like, disgusting. So what I had to do literally was I would pick up parts of the grass, move it over to the other side, flip, not that way, flip horizontal, and put better grass. Because see how it's all, like, growing up and stuff?
Yeah.
So anyway, that's basically, it took a while to go. I'm showing you the really fast version of it, but it took a while to get through. And you can see I haven't masked that stuff yet, but
nice.
Anyway, it worked. It just it just took a little bit of doing.
Yeah, I love the grass thing of just getting down low and
It worked
just
wonderfully.
Eliminating
well.
The cars and the tourists.
Because when you're standing there it is, and I just like, what if I get down low? What if I get down? And then I realized how far I had to get was literally my camera on the grass. All right, last thing I want to show you, because we really are like way crazy out of time, is I want to show you these shots. So these are just a collection of shots, and I just want to go through them real quick just to show you. So this one, which I like, that's taken from the top of the typewriter.
That's nice.
I think that's a nice, it's a pano. That one's nice.
Mm-hmm.
These are nice. Nice, nice.
Nice.
Nice. A little. It's in the park. A little park.
Coffee.
That's a different shot of the. Right? There's that. The staircase. There's the Trevi fountains. Right. That's inside that private church. That's inside Mimi Akoko. That's another nice shot. I love that shot. I didn't take any of these. Every one of these was taken by my wife with her iPhone. And I wanted to show this because I think a lot of people think, I'm gonna need like a ton of gear. I need to have all this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I think these are beautiful shots. Now, I will say this. My wife, number one, has a great eye.
Yeah, she
she really does. And now, I get a little bit of credit on the staircase because I told her, honey, go in that room. There's nobody there, quick. Because she didn't even know the staircase exists. I was like at the Vatican knowing I'm gonna find this. No matter what, I was gonna get there. But anyway, she's just got a great eye. All of these are taken. By the way, I do zero post-processing on her images. She does. She won't even let me post-process because people will write her on. She's on Google Plus. People go, "Oh, I know
you're
passing."
You have an unfair advantage.
She does it. Believe it or not, she does it all in Camera Plus, the app Camera mm-hmm. Plus. Because what she does is, while we're standing at the Vatican, she posts it. There's no way for me to get the image, get my laptop. Hold on, Father, stop the mass. I'm going to get my laptop. She uses Camera Plus. She does all her own post-processing, and she uses two or three things. She uses their clarity, they have clarity.
Mm-hmm.
She uses their vignette. She'll put a black border, like right here, a black border or something. She does it all herself, and it's all on her iPhone. She'll tell you what her secret is to iPhone photography. You know what it is?
What's that?
She treats it like it's a DSLR. It's the only camera she has. And where the rest of us, we'll pull out ours to take like a family pic or something else.
Yeah.
But when it's a serious photo, we grab for this. When it's a serious photo, she uses her iPhone. And she will take the time and set up, like she's beside me with her phone, with her arms through, taking the shot in the grass while I'm right over there with my DSLR.
Yeah.
It's an 8-megapixel camera.
Does she have any of the, does she use any of the little?
She has the Olio clips,
Olio clips,
but she didn't bring any of them.
Really?
These are all done straight out of her iPhone. full screen size. They're 8-megapixel cameras. This is an iPhone pano. I hate to say it, I don't have a single shot of the Colosseum that's as good as this.
My first DSLR was 8-pixel, I think.
No,
even
my
less.
My first was 6.
Yeah, like 6.3 or something like that.
Canon Rebel. So anyway, these are all shot right. I'm like, really? And she's showing me these things on the, and she's posting them, and I'm like, oh, so you know what I did do? I got just one. There's these two guys that had some Sony gear. And they were all like, you know, Sony this and so on. And they keep bugging me. Oh, my Sony produces in the panel in the thing. You know, he was German. He really was. He says, and
I was
so
gonna say you're Italian.
So,
doesn't sound
so
good.
He takes a pano of the Circus Maximus, and he shows me on the back of his camera. And he goes, look, I do it in camera. And I go, really? I reach in my pocket, I pull out my iPhone, I do a pano. Now the iPhone has a Sony sensor and built-in pano. I show him, and it's exactly the same. Dude, it looked like we took the exact same picture. And then he goes, oh, well, you know, but you know, mine's 24 megapixels. I said, really? Let's put it on the web. Ready? Go. And he and his buddy bust cracked up. Because I'm on a phone.
Yeah.
I got a cellular connection. I can have it on the web in 2 seconds. They would have to go back to their hotel room, back to their computer, process it, get an internet
compress
connection.
The living daylights
compress
out of
the
it.
Living daylights all anyway it was kind of fun cool. So I could show you more and more and more, but I mean we're way over time.
I got one more question to ask you.
Yes, sure.
Before that, we're just got a couple giveaways here. So we got to give away the Rogue lighting kit and the Canon Vixia Mini. So Brad is going to get on picking winners for that. Last question for you.
Yeah.
So overall impression of Rome. And I asked because I know we talked about this because you had some thoughts going in.
Yeah. So my overall impression of Rome, and this is why I wanted to bring up this airfare from Aer Lingus, it was very different than I expected. Now, I've been all over Europe. I've been all over Italy. I mean, it's weird. I've never been to Rome. This was my first trip. And yeah. I was to Venice before I was married 24 years ago. So it was one of my wife and I, like our first trips, you know, as a couple. It was very different in that it was very much an old city. Even though it's a huge city and a big metropolitan city, there are no tall buildings. You can take an elevator up to the top of the typewriter and you see this expanse out over Rome. And the only tall buildings are the Dome and the St. Peter's Basilica, you know, the Tower from the Vatican. I mean, it's like, it's so old. And you don't have a McDonald's on every corner. It's not like, you know, Paris is so commercial. And I love Paris. It's a beautiful city, but it's a very commercial city. Rome is commercial, but it's hidden. Mm-hmm. Like, the McDonald's aren't in your face. There's not a Starbucks on every corner.
You're not walking down this beautiful street and you see a Burger King sign.
No, absolutely not. And that's what surprised me. I really fell in love with it. I expected to kind of think, it was nice. I enjoyed it. But it was actually much better than I expected. It had a lot more charm, a lot more quaintness, and like Paris, every time you turn a corner, there's another amazing little view. So everybody kept telling me it's a wonderful city for photography. There is. I don't feel like I even began to do it any justice at all. I would like to do what I never get to do, and not because I never get to do it because I choose it, but I don't get to do it because I want my family there. Mm-hmm. Like I would love to go to Rome for a week and just shoot to your heart's content. But given the choice, I will always want to be with my wife and kids. So it's like, I'm never going to be that guy. I'm never going to be that travel photographer that goes to a town and is on assignment and stays there for 2 weeks. It's just not me. I love the travel part of it too much. I love to go shopping. I love the great restaurants. I love sightseeing. I love doing stupid touristy things. I went and did and shot every stupid touristy thing you can do in Rome. So I still like all that stuff.
And you like to sleep.
I love to sleep late. And I love to have room service. Hey, there's a... two last things. Phil says, is there a particular camera bag you would recommend for travel? Say that you use one that you're comfortable and carrying the minimal gear necessary. I don't carry a camera bag, period. I use a camera bag to get me to Rome or to get me to whatever city, and then the camera bag never leaves the room. Yeah. All that is with me. So Phil, this and a camera and one lens. That is it. So that is what I carry everywhere, is just this. Getting there, I use a Think Tank bag. What's it called, Brad? The little roller. We use the little Think Tank roller.
It's Airport.
It's a Think Tank Airport.
Airstream.
Airstream small. Airstream, a little small one. It's amazing. It's wonderful. It fits under the seat of commercial planes, a small commercial plane. Lots of people asked, can Calibra do an iPhoneography class for Kelby training? I've talked to her about that. She will not do it. But she's got a brand new show that she's getting ready to kick off, and it runs, I think, every other week, and it's called Our Show. And she's going to be covering all kinds of topics. And one of the topics she's going to do in one of the first shows is how she processes her photos. Because I think at some point she wants to go, look, I know my husband's a Photoshop guy, but I don't let him touch it. She doesn't. And she said, I said, you know, honey, I could do a blog post about it and say, look, and I'll do it. She goes, people that want to believe it, it doesn't matter what you say.
Yeah.
So she's going to show you on her show. And I'll have, if you watch my Google Plus or Facebook, I'll have details when her show launches. You know who her first guest is? Jay and Verena Patel.
Oh, yeah?
They're her first guest. They're amazing landscape photographers. Yeah. I mean, I love their work. The Patels. They're the people I want to be when I grow up as landscape photographers. They're just unbelievable. They're her first guest.
That's awesome.
I know. She's rocking it.
Yeah,
hey, winners, Matt.
All right, winners. So the winner of the Rogue Portrait Lighting Kit is Chris McDonald, and the Vixia is Onyx 808. So congratulations to you guys. We'll ship it out.
All right. Well, thank you guys so much for watching with us. I want to thank Canon for giving us a wonderful giveaway to Rogue and to B&H Photo, our sponsors. I also want to apologize to all of our video crew and friends here who stayed much later than anybody was expecting to. So thank you guys, and thanks in the control room. And thanks to you, Matt, for hanging out here. I know you probably wanted to be home as well.
No, that's fun.
But
so it was a good time.
Thanks, everybody. I hope this I hope this inspires you to see what you can do with Lightroom. Because this is great. There's a second part that can be just as much fun.
Yeah.
And I love to shoot, but I also love to post-process. And I think that Lightroom is one of those tools that can really make that part of it really, really fun. And you can see at what points you need to jump to Photoshop. A lot of people ask that. Do I need Photoshop? I think today you saw some of the things you need to jump to Photoshop.
Not much,
we didn't
though.
Do panos. We didn't do HDR. We didn't do any of that stuff. So there's plenty of stuff we could have done in Photoshop. But we can do so much in Lightroom today. It's unbelievable.
And sharing. Sharing with the book.
Yeah, and sharing with the book.
Make a book.
At the end, you hit one button, publish to send a blurb, and they give you the price and all right before you even leave Lightroom.
Cool.
All right, everybody. Thanks very much. Matt, thank you.
Hey, you're welcome.
And we'll see you guys next time. Take care, everybody.
Take care, everybody.
Bonjour, mesdames et messieurs. Bienvenue à Paris. Poulet, pommes frites et jambon. La donne, la tête, la pillée. Je suis fatigué. Voulez manger la fromage. La voiture, elle pour rapide, cloque monsieur. Monsieur Beaujolais, avec fâche. Je suis fatigué. Vraiment, j'ai la fromage. La voiture, et pour la rapide, cloque monsieur. L'addition, s'il vous plaît. Au revoir. La fromage.